So now we are coming to simplicial approximation. Given two simplicial complexes K and L, look at all the functions which are simplicial maps from K to L. Naturally, you can think of, take the mod phi and think of this as a continuous function from mod K to mod L. But that will be a very special kind of continuous function, which is much smaller than set of all continuous functions. Question is how big it is. Indeed, what we are going to see is it is not too small. Every continuous function can be approximated by a simplicial map. That is a simplicial approximation theorem. It is not all that straightforward like smooth approximations here. The point is that if you keep K and L fixed, you are not going to get simplicial approximation. What you will have to do is, you will have to keep dividing the domain according to the function that you want to approximate. And this dividing is precisely what we have introduced last time, subdivisions. Especially, we are going to use barycentric subdivision, and we will solve this problem only for K finite. Okay? Take K1 and K2 be simplicial complexes, and mod F from mod K1 to mod K2 a continuous map. We say phi a simplicial map, a simplicial approximation to F. Okay, a simplicial approximation to F. The F is there. If the following condition holds, namely, suppose you have some F alpha inside the closed simplex F2. F2 is a simplex in K2. F alpha happens to be inside the closed simplex K2. Then the corresponding image of alpha under mod phi should be also inside F2. For all alpha in K1, mod K1, and F2 in K2, whenever this happens. So in other words, the image of mod phi and image under mod phi of every point should not go away too far. Okay? If it's in a simplex, it should be inside that simplex. So this is the way we want to do the thing. Here, the farness and nearness is measured out of simplicity inside K2. You don't want any distance and so on here. So here is a picture. For some alpha, F alpha has come here in that triangle, inside this triangle. Now phi alpha is also in the triangle, it's on the boundary of the triangle. So this is okay. Now here look at F beta. Is inside this one simplex in the edge, whereas phi beta is inside the larger triangle. So this is where the condition that we started has failed, because what should have happened is phi beta should be also inside this F, inside this one simplex. Okay. So you have to choose the condition correctly. You can say F beta is in this triangle, so phi beta is here. So that is true. But if you choose F beta to be inside one simplex, then this condition is not satisfied. So that is the meaning of this condition. For every F2 which contains in mod F, which contains F alpha, you should have this property. So this F2 and alpha is taken whatever, F2 is also floated here. For all F2 which has this property, whenever this happens, it should be true. This is the way. So I hope this is clear. This point is clear. Okay. If L1 is a subcomplex of K1, and phi and eps are all as above, one is a simplicity approximation of the other one. That's what I am not repeating these conditions here. Okay. And if phi is a simplicity approximation to f, then phi restricted to L1, okay, will be automatically simplicity approximation to f restricted to mod L1. Because the conditions are satisfied for the larger simplicial complex K1, it will be satisfied for the restricted thing also. The beauty is, suppose F is already induced by a simplicial map on K1 to K2, or from L1 to L1 to K, whatever, some subcomplex. Then a simplicial approximation will be equal to the map. Equal to this, phi is giving you f, so psi is giving you f, phi must be equal to it, psi. So this is the meaning. Whenever the map is already simplicial, a simplicial approximation to that will be itself. This is quite different from other kind of approximation that we are doing. Okay. So how does this one follow? This follows by simple observation that instead of taking arbitrary point alpha, you take a vertex V1. Then F of V is a vertex because F is simplicial, right? So I can take this vertex F of V to be capital F. Then phi V must be also inside that singular vertex, so it must be F V. The importance of simplicity approximation stems from what happens in the homotopy aspect. So that's what this lemma says. Okay, suppose F is a simplicial, F is a continuous map, and V is a simplicial approximation. Okay, on a subset, A contains a K1, suppose mod phi is equal to F A. They agree there. Okay. This A may be empty, I don't care. Suppose this happens, then mod phi is homotopic to F relative to this set A. F A must be equal to mod phi A if you want relative homotopy, first of all. So that is necessary. But that's it. Now, how does this follow? Because of the condition that FA and mod phi A, FA, F of X or F of alpha, mod phi of alpha, always are inside a single closed simplex. A closed simplex has convex structure. Therefore, you can join these to them by a line segment, and that gives you homotopy. So that's precisely what I'm going to give. Take H of alpha T by T times F alpha plus 1 minus T times mod phi of alpha. This is obviously homotopy. On each simplex, okay, containing F alpha, this makes sense. If you take a boundary of that by chance, then if you pass to the other simplex, the two structures will be the same. The line segments are the same. So this defines a valid, you know, very good function, first of all, and it is linear in each of these, so it is continuous. So all these things now I'm sure that you can verify by yourself. Okay, so that's why I have written just this homotopy, and this will be homotopy. T equal to 0, what happens? It is a mod phi alpha. T equal to 1, it is F. So this is homotopy. So now we go towards how to get a simplicial approximation starting with a continuous function. Okay. So a little more elaborate analysis of the definition that we have given. is involved in this lemma. And that will lead you to get the function, the simplicial function that we are looking for. So first of all, a simplicial approximation, whatever, should be a vertex map. And then it must be a simplicial map. And then it must be approximation, that approximation condition should be satisfied. Okay. So start with the vertex function first of all. Okay, where k1 and k2 are simplicial complexes. Suppose f from mod k to mod k1 to mod k2, a continuous function, and this phi, which is a set theoretic function on the vertex set, satisfies certain properties. So these A, B, C are all equivalent. Okay, so what is this first condition? For every V in K1, namely a vertex, F of star of V should be contained inside star of V. I recall what is the star of a vertex. Star of a vertex is all those alphas such that alpha of V is not equal to zero. It's called star of V, it's an open star of V. It has star-shaped subset. At the vertex V, it is star shaped. Okay. So F of this open set, F of star of V, should be inside star of phi V. Phi V is another vertex, which is a vertex inside K2. So star of that should contain this one. It should not go out of that. Okay. For every alpha in mod K1, the support of alpha. Support of alpha is a simplex. Okay. Phi of that is a simplex. I don't know. Right? Because phi was only a vertex map. Phi of support of F must be not only a simplex, but it must be contained inside a support of F alpha. Support of any point in mod K1, mod K2 here, is a simplex of F2, simplex of K2. Okay. Once it is contained inside a simplex, this will be also a simplex. It should be contained inside that. It may be equal also, no problem. The third condition is, suddenly, phi is a simplicial approximation to F. So these two first two conditions are equivalent to the definition. The definition does not even assume that phi is simplicial and so on. Phi is simplicial, it assumes. Here, I don't have even simplicial. Simplicialness I am putting here. Only I am putting a vertex map. After all, to define a function on the simplicial complex, you have to first get a set theoretic function on the vertex sets. So that is only set theory. After that, this gives you immediately what that it's a simplicity approximation, either condition A or condition B. Okay, and they are equivalent. That is the content of this lemma. Let us go through this proof carefully, because that understanding that one is important here, not only just the statement, but how it comes out. That will reveal you what simplicity approximations are about. So let us prove A implies B. The first condition A only says that F of star of V is contained the star of PV. Then I have to show that phi of support of alpha is contained inside support of F alpha. So I start with a point inside support of alpha. I have to show that phi V is inside here, right? Support of V is in support of alpha implies, this is by definition, it's actually equivalent. We have used that one also. Alpha V is positive, which is same thing as again equivalent to alpha is in star V. Okay, so this is like duality. V is in support of alpha means alpha is in star V. And conversely, of course, up till here it's fine. Now, this implies F alpha is in star of V by condition A. Right? F of star V is in this one. So if alpha is here, alpha f of alpha will be in star of Vb. Okay, that's condition A. Now we can go back. Something is in star of Vb means f alpha operating on a Vb, evaluated Vb is positive. But that is same thing as Vb is in support of f alpha. So we have completed proof of B. A implies B is over. This step can be exactly reversed to get B implies A, but only you have to use the different hypothesis. The hypothesis there become conclusion now. Okay, so I am rewriting it. B implies A. Start with alpha inside star V. Okay. We have to show that F alpha is in star of VV. That's what you have to show. Using condition that if something happens, that condition is there, no, in B. Okay. So alpha is in star V. Since alpha V is positive, just like here, V is in support of alpha. But by condition B, VV will be in the support of F alpha. Okay, here it was condition A, now here we have reversing. PV is condition F alpha. Right? But that is the meaning of F alpha of PV is positive, which is same thing as F alpha is in star of V. So it's exactly reversing the arrows here. Okay, A implies B. A and B are equivalent. Now we want to prove that A and C are equivalent. Right? If you assume A, you can assume B also, because A and B are same now. Okay, if you assume B, then it's same thing as assuming A. So you can take both advantage of both of them, and that is what is going to happen. So first I'll prove C implies A. Okay, C is a simplicial, C gives you that phi is a simplicial approximation. Okay, so fix a V belonging to K1. And alpha is in star of B. We want to prove A. So what we have to prove? F alpha is in star of VV, whatever. Okay. We have to show that F alpha of VV is not equal to 0. That will mean that it is in the star of VV. Right? So this is what we have to prove starting with alpha. So let F2 equal to support of F alpha. That means at each point of F2, F alpha is not zero. That is the meaning of support of F alpha, right? Clearly, F alpha is in mod F2. It's actually in the interior. So it's definitely in mod F2. By hypothesis, simplicial approximation hypothesis now, implies that mod phi of alpha is also in F2. Okay. But now look at what is the definition of mod phi. Mod phi of alpha at phi v or some v prime is sum of all the alpha v's where v comes to this v prime, phi v equal to that. So in particular, this is phi v already. So alpha v will be definitely there plus some more terms which are all coming to phi v under phi. All those alpha of those points are also there. Doesn't matter. This alpha V is there, and this alpha V plus something is there, okay, some non-negative terms. So which is bigger than alpha V? Bigger than or equal to alpha V. And alpha V itself is already positive because alpha is in star V. Therefore, this phi V is inside F2, okay? By definition, for all V, whatever you have taken, okay, we have shown that phi v, this phi of phi alpha of f, phi alpha of phi v is positive. Okay, therefore, this phi v must be inside F2. Okay, but F2 is the support of f alpha. So this implies f alpha of phi v itself is not zero. Okay, so what may happen is, you have chosen F2 like this, so that F alpha is in the interior. But phi alpha might have gone here, it doesn't matter. Okay. it will not get out of this simplex. This is the point, because alpha is not equal to zero. Yes. Now finally, A implies C. Okay, so I have told you, if we assume A, the hypothesis B also comes to your rescue. So you can use whichever one you like. So first, to show that phi is a simplicial map. Right now, what is given? Phi is only a vertex map satisfying A. Now I have to first show that it's a simplicial map. What is the meaning of simplicial map? Take a simplex, image must be a simplex in K2. Okay. That is what you have to show. Take a simplex V0, V1, VQ equal to F1 in K1. Okay. Then the barycenter F1 twiddle, which is V0 plus V1 plus VQ divided by Q plus 1, that is an element of mod F1. It is actually in the interior of mod F1. Okay. Not only that, it actually belongs to star of VIs for each of them, because the coefficient, the value of VGI is 1 by n plus 1, for 1 by q plus 1 for each of them. So this element F1 twiddle operating upon a VI is not zero, so it is in star of VI for each I. Therefore, this intersection of star of VIs is non-empty. A beta twiddle is there, F1 twiddle is there. So F of that twin will be also non-empty. If we have a non-empty set, F of that will be definitely non-empty. Okay. But F of an intersection is contained in the intersections of the FIs. F of star VIs. And each of star VIs is contained inside star of phi VIs. That is our condition A. Therefore, this intersection is non-empty. This intersection is non-empty means what? There is a beta, some element, which belongs to the intersection, which means star of phi VI evaluated at beta, okay, beta evaluated phi VI is not zero for each of them. Okay, it's intersection. That would mean that phi1, phi2, this phi VI, phi VI, phi VI, etc. must be a simplex, because every point beta of K2, mod K2 is inside some simplex, closed simplex. Therefore, phi VI is in support of beta, right? These are all in support of beta. Support of any point inside mod K2 is a simplex, okay? So, phi of F1 is a simplex in K2. All these phi VIs which are inside this one is a subset of that. Okay, phi V1, phi V2, phi naught, V0, VQ, they are phi of F1. They are subset of this one. So it is a simplex. So you have proved that phi is a simplicial map. Now it must be shown that it is a simplicial approximation to F. So that part is easier. To show that phi is simply approximation, start with any alpha in mod K1 such that F alpha is in F2, mod F2. We have to show that what? Phi of alpha, mod phi of alpha is also in F2. This is what you have to show. First of all, F alpha is in F2 means support of F alpha is a subset of F2. Okay. Since we have to prove A implies B, we can use condition B also. Sorry, we have proved A implies B already. We can use condition B also, from which it follows that support of mod phi alpha, which is equal to phi of support of alpha, is contained in support of F alpha. This is the condition B. Okay, just now support of F alpha is contained in F2 we have seen. So support of mod phi of alpha is inside F2. It just means that phi alpha is inside mod F2. So now we can harvest this criteria which we have got. We can use that to get another criteria for simplicial approximation. Take any map K1 to K2, which is a continuous function, mod k1 to mod k2, admits simplicial approximations. You don't know what they are. If and only if this is purely conditioned in terms of f, okay, if and only if k1 is finer than this open covering, star v varies over where v varies over all the vertices. This is an open covering for mod k2. Take f inverse of that, that will be an open covering for mod k1. So that is my u. Members of u are f inverse of star v. That covering, okay, have the property that mod this k1 is finer than this, just means that for each star v is contained in one of the members here. Remember, the finer means that. Okay, so what is the proof? Let vi denote the vertex set of ki, v1 and v2 are vertices of k1 and k2. K1 is finer than u just means that each star v, okay, let us say star u, u is inside v1, is contained inside f inverse of star v for some v. Okay, that is the meaning of finer. So what means that there is a definement function phi from v1 to v2 such that f of star u is contained in star of phi u. What is it? I am writing that as refinement function. The same thing as saying if you take f inverse, star u is contained inside f inverse of star phi u. Whatever v I get, I am calling it as phi u. So that is a refinement function. This function is a set theory function now. You see, the condition in the theorem, in this lemma, there is no reference to phi. Now I have cooked up the function phi here. Namely, it's a refinement function from one vertex set to another vertex set. Okay, so that is my phi. It is a vertex map. But this has the another, now use the previous lemma. Okay, this will tell you that previous lemma, phi is a simplicial approximation to f. If this condition is satisfied, phi is a simplicial approximation. The refinement function itself becomes a simplicial approximation. There may be many. All of them will be simplicial approximation to f. Okay, now we know how to get a simplicial approximation to a given function. What we must do is, the k1 that you choose here, mod k1 is homeomorphic to this space, whatever. Okay. That must be finer than the open covering here. So once you have chosen k1, how to make this one, we know. What? Namely, go on taking barycentric subdivision. Divide, divide, divide till it becomes very fine. That's the meaning of finer. So it must be finer than the covering. That is the last thing. Okay. If k1 and k2 our simplicial complex says f from mod k1 to k2 is a continuous map. K1 is finite. K2 could be anything. Then there exists an integer n such that for all n bigger than n, there are simplicial approximations phi from where? From not from k1. From the iterated barycentric subdivision of k1 to k2. So these maps are defined not on K1, but on a finer subdivision, and they will be approximation to F. Once your N is sufficiently large, namely, you know how to choose this capital N. Okay. Q divided by 1 plus Q, Q sorry, Q divided, huh, Q plus 1 raised to N should go to, keeps going to 0. So it should be less than your epsilon. For epsilon is what, whatever the Lebesgue number and so on. So that part we have seen last time. Remember that. So that is the meaning of combining lemma of 6.4 and 6.2. 6.2 about finer subdivision. 6.4 says once it is finer like this, then you are done. So simplicial approximation theorem is proved. Okay, this has similar applications, similar to what? Similar to smooth approximations in differential topology, multivariate calculus that you may have learned. Okay, but it obviously has wider applicability because here we are not taking manifolds at all. Our things could be highly, you know, corner things may be there, non-smooth. Okay, triangle, you know, tetrahedrons and so on. Okay, and things built up of that, very crooked paths and so on could be there. Okay, but there are other types of even larger things, namely CW complexes, and they have also this kind of CW approximations. In some sense, they have a wider applicability than simplicial approximations. Okay, but simplicial approximations have the great advantage, you know, if you K1 and K2 are sometimes simplicial complexes that are given, and if you specify a few properties of a continuous function f, even the computer can find a simplicial approximation to it. Just some, a few more, you have to give some information. What is f? You have to give some information about how, what is happening to f, some geometric information, it will do that. This kind of thing is not possible to CW approximations and so on. Okay, so there are a lot of advantages also as compared to other approximations. So some immediate corollaries, some of these things can be done by smooth approximations also. So it is not that these are the advantages, no. So this corollary is immediate, namely, take any function from one sphere to another sphere of higher dimension, Sn to Sn plus k, where k is at least 1. Any such map is null homotopy. The proof is very simple. You have to think of Sn given by, you know, the underlying topological space or geometric realization of the boundary of delta n plus 1. This we have seen already. Take k1 equal to boundary of delta n plus 1, mod k1 will be Sn. Similarly, mod k2 will be boundary of delta n plus k plus 1. One dimension higher you have to take each time. Okay. Then your f is a map from mod k1 to mod k2. Therefore, after dividing k1 sufficiently many times, I don't want to write it, what it is, my st of n sum for some n. This has nothing to do with that n. Okay. So it's k1 prime is some subdivision. You have a simplicial map which approximates f. Okay. We know that f is homotopic to mod phi. Mod phi is again from mod k1 to mod k2. So f is also mod k1 to mod k2, right? These two are homotopic to each other. That's what we have seen. That's the importance of simplicial approximation. Okay. So to study the homotopy behavior of f, I can pass on to now phi mod phi, because these two are homotopic. I want to show that f is homotopic to constant map. I should show that mod phi is homotopic to constant. But mod phi has better properties, namely because simplicial map, its image is contained inside maximum nth skeleton. Okay, image of any n simplex here, that this maximal simplex is here, cannot be bigger than dimension n. It will be n simplex or some smaller dimension simplex, because that is a linear map. Okay, this part we have seen. So it is contained as an nth skeleton of K2. But K2, you know, is n plus k dimensional thing. There are n plus k dimensional cells also. So all those things are not covered. It just means that mod phi is not a surjective function. Now this is one of simple exercise I had given. You have to better work it out. Namely, any function into a sphere which is not surjective. That means this is one point. Just one point is enough. Okay, one point is missed. Then it is homotopic to a constant function. Okay. So you have seen this proof, must be you have seen this proof by now. So simplicial approximation theorem is valid over arbitrary simplicial complexes also. Instead of just finite, we have assumed domain is K1 is finite, right? That is not a necessity. Only this proof it was needed. Okay. But to prove it in general case, you cannot just use barycentric subdivision. You have to go for arbitrary subdivisions also. Okay. So let us stop here. Next time we will derive another commutator result out of this simplicial approximation. Thank you.